afternoon. Welcome to EdSat Network. Friend, as you know, this week we have organized a lecture on sociological thinker. As you know, we have already discussed the sociological thinker Weber, Durkheim, Parson in the other months. And this week we will discuss mainly of Robert Merton and G.H. Mead. And if the time permit, we will also talk about the Weber bureaucracy and all that. And for discussion on this very topic, we have an eminent sociological thinker, Dr. Subhas Mahapatra. He teaches sociology in Delhi University and has his own way of teaching in a very simple language. He conveys the meaning and the message what this sociological thinker has talked about. So I hope his knowledge will help us to understand in a new perspective of the sociological thinker Robert Merton. So on your behalf, I welcome Dr. Subhas Mahapatra for a research lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, coordinator. I'm immensely pleased to come back here once again to discuss with you about various dimensions to sociological understanding of reality. Most of the sociologists, they have a reflexive understanding about the grassroots. If you look into the sociocultural background of Robert K. Merton, you would notice that he is a Russian Jew who migrated to America and subsequently gave a new dimension to sociological imagination. Merton had a very interesting childhood in Philadelphia. He was a magician in his childhood, and he had a lot of exposure to different kinds of cultural, religious, and social activities in his neighborhood area. And he writes that from my neighborhood area, I got cultural capital, social capital. I got emotional support from the members of my neighborhood area. But what I really missed out is economic capital. He was a marginal man, a refugee, but with a lot much of primarily, you know, core understanding about the social happening surrounding him. Therefore, his sociology is a reflection of how the minorities in case of a pluralistic society, they evolve into full-fledged personalities. Robert K. Merton's sociology came under the influence of Talcott Parsons. Therefore, it is difficult to understand Merton without having some kind of understanding about Parsonian sociology. Talcott Parsons is interested to develop grand theories in sociology, and he tells that society works as a system where different parts are harmonically interrelated to each other. Society has organismic system, personality system, social system, and cultural system. These distinctive parts of the social system are continuously negotiating with each other. Organismic system is receiving inputs from the environment, passing it on to personality system, that gets into social system and ultimately cultural system. The harmony between all these parts of the society make the society working. Therefore, Parsons tells that society is an integrative system. And if there is a change taking place in society, change cannot be arbitrary in character. Every change is a negotiated change. Every change is a deliberative change. So change is a continuous process affecting to social life. But change never leads to disruption. Change brings forward a new kind of continuity as against old form of continuity. And Parsonian sociology is largely developing as a critique to Marxian sociology, as Marx talks about revolution is foundation to social change. But Parsons, in defense of capitalism, industrial society, he tells change is a continuous endeavor that comes through negotiation that come through adaptation, that come through communication between various parts of the society. You know, Robert K. Merton looks at society differently from the standpoint of Parsons, indicating that the major problem with Parsonian sociology is that it is overcommitted to the question of integration. Integration cannot be guaranteed in social life. Society is a sum total of different parts where one finds out. Each part may be negotiating with the other part, but at times there is a strain and conflict between various parts of the society which need to be highlighted. Society is not a lifeless mechanism. You know, at times we can see that education structure is producing so many graduates that unemployment is evolving into a big problem. Therefore, education supplies manpower to industry. Education is contributing for the growth of efficient, effective political leadership. Education is making contribution to knowledge industry and also making contribution to bureaucracy. So, education has immense functional potentials, but when education is primarily contributing for acceleration of unemployment, one can look into this education having a dysfunctional role towards the larger society. Therefore, one cannot just say that every institution present in society is having necessarily functional role to play towards other institutions and society at large. Therefore, Merton is more committed to explain the realistic aspect of social life than being primarily, you know, coming forward with the conclusion that integration, harmony, interdependency is the other name of society. I'll be looking into Robert K. Merton's sociology from two perspectives. One is his criticism to Marxian sociology and Parsonian sociology. And second, his novelty he's introducing into the domain of sociology. If one looks into sociology of Talcott Parsons, Parsonian theory is emphasizing on three different aspects of society. First, he talks about functional unity. That means unity among various parts of the society. Then he talks about functional universality. It means the function of a given institution is universally same, irrespective of society and time. And third is functional indispensability. That means a particular institution can only undertake a function that cannot be spelled out, undertaken by the other institutions. Therefore, these three propositions of Parsonian theory are questioned by Robert K. Merton. Therefore, Mertonian sociology stands on the premise of critique to Talcott Parsons. And second, he develops some brilliant concepts like self-fulfilling prophecy. Here he is criticizing to Karl Marx. He tells in certain situation, we develop certain kind of ideas, people work on it, and the intended result comes out. When the intended result comes out, people start celebrating to this ideology, self-fulfilling prophecy. But in many situations, there are certain kind of ideologies which are spelled out by the people, institutions, but they never come into the reality in absolute sense of the term. That leads to self-defeating prophecy. He tells it is not always guaranteed that communist revolution can bring forward social transformation. The impact of communist revolution may be largely variant from one society to another society, from one point of time to another point of time, from one context to another context. Therefore, social life should not be taken for granted. Social life is full up with permutations and combinations. Hence, one should develop an empirical view about social life than developing a generalized, idealistic understanding of society. Let me just thread together Morton's criticism to Parsonian theory, first addressing to the question of functional unity. He tells unity between the parts of a society cannot be taken for granted. If we look into a small society like a tribal society or a peasant society, it is evident to see that economic life of the society is strongly related to cultural life of the society. Because people, before they initiate harvest, they go for rituals. And ritual is initiated by the village chief or the tribal chief. Therefore, religious structure, economic structure, and at the same time, social and cultural structure are embedded to each other. But in modern society, it is too difficult to believe that disharmonic institutions, atomized institutions, can ever internalize to common values, common ethos, common norms in identical manner. Therefore, functional theory is so nice to explain the life, integrative life of the people living in simple societies. And when we apply this functional theory to modern society, we need to go for certain kind of modification in this theory. Because theories are not good, they are not bad. One must have to keep some space to revise these theories, to negotiate with the changing situation and changing context. Therefore, Robert K. Morton tells that grand system theory of persons need to be revised. Because in modern society, we have so many institutions. And each institution consists of so many bodies of people coming from different backgrounds, driven by different identities. They are joining institutions for varieties of purpose. Therefore, all these individuals manifesting action, when they take the institutions into a functional level, one cannot guarantee their association with the institution can be necessarily always functional in character. Therefore, empirical situation must be respected than glorifying functionality. He goes on to say that functional unity is only concerned about how different parts of the social life are integrated to each other. It is absolutely ignoring the question of structure. Therefore, fundamental concern of sociology is to switch over from function study to structure study. He tells that in every society there are present structural components like family, religion, school, peer group. So all these structural parts of the society are internalizing to values, usages, norms prescribed by culture in different proportion. So how these structures and norms are negotiating with each other? And how this negotiation is producing different kinds of consequence? That should be the fundamental concern of sociology. Therefore, sociology should not be taking function for granted. It must be looking into what is actually happening within the structure. I'm citing one example here. You know, family is a structure. The parents are socializing children in every family identically. But one child may be manifesting certain kind of deviant behavior, whereas another child is manifesting genius. Two children are socialized by same parents, but their integration with family, their internalization of norms of the family is really different. Therefore, family is not a functional entity to the total society. Within family, there is present tension. Between family and school, there is present tension. between school, family and social structure, there is present tension. Therefore, how this tension evolves, how this tension is negotiated, how this tension giving rise to different kinds of consequences, this should be the subject matter of sociology. Therefore, functional unity should not be given importance. What need to be given importance is how this unity is being primarily questioned, challenged, altered, modified on a continuous basis. There is addressing to the issues of functional universality. Functional universality theory that tells economy in every society is engaged in adopting rules. Political system in every society is concerned about goal specification and goal attainment. Government in every society, law in every society is concerned about integrative issues. And family, kinship and religion, they are mostly concerned about pattern maintenance and tension management. These are the universal functional role of different parts of the society according to Talcott Parsons. Morton tells that sociology should not be committed to the study of functions only. He tells there are two kinds of propositions. One is function and other is dysfunction. And functions are not only always visible. Functions can be manifest and functions can be latent. Therefore, a sociologist must have to develop an empirical understanding about functional, dysfunctional and non-functional relationship between different institutions in a given society. Therefore, he rejects outrightly the thesis that there is present universal functional role attached to every institution in society. Rather, the subject matter of sociology should be the analysis of functions, dysfunctions and non-functions. He gives some brilliant examples. You know, suppose students go to the university to obtain graduation degree or post-graduation degree. When they come out of the university carrying this degree and subsequently enter into job market, we can say that the functions of the university is to supply manpower to the industry. But we are forgetting here, university is offering a space for political socialization of the children. They are contesting in the university elections. They are going for different kinds of campaigns, taking up your different kinds of issues. So this kind of training in the college and the university are subsequently helping these children to grow up into the political leaders in future. Therefore, these are the implicit functional roles of the university which must be taken into consideration. Also, one finds out universities and colleges, they have a series of dysfunctional roles as well. Dysfunctional role will include that when the students are not going for a particular kind of course on the basis of their choice, they are carried away by the compulsions of the market. Their interest in a particular stream of knowledge is absolutely lost. Education becomes a pathological experience for the child. Then there is a great possibility that a child, instead of continuing with the course, may simply drop out or may not be meaningfully using that for the gratification of his own needs and the needs of the society. Therefore, every institution to every other institution is having a series of manifest roles, latent roles, which may be functional, dysfunctional and non-functional. Hence, the fundamental concern of sociology is to develop a balance sheet of which institution to which other institution is primarily playing functional, dysfunctional, non-functional roles to what extent. that I'll be taking up subsequently in my discussions of how this latent and manifest orientations discussed by Robert K. Merton is giving a new dimension to sociological understanding of reality. The third criticism he is offering to functional theory is functional indispensability. Functional indispensability considers that there is no functional alternatives to the roles allocated to a given social institutions. He is developing AGIL model and tells adaptation is the role of the economic system. Goal attainment is the role of government. Integration is the role of law and latency is the role of family. These roles are unamendable. These roles cannot be altered. But Merton tells, no, that's not possible. There are many institutions present in a society which are undertaking same kind of role. And at the same time, one role is not only played by different institutions. Different institutions combinedly together are also addressing to same kind of needs. Therefore, different institutions are undertaking varieties of roles, injecting certain kind of dynamism into social life. Take for example, social control. Social control as a form of role is being initiated in modern society by policing system, court of law. But if we go to tribal societies, we'll find out that elderly people, they control the behavior of youngsters. Therefore, social control, that is the function of policing system in modern society, is the function of the seniors in case of family system in a tribal society. Therefore, contexts are different, institutions are different, but functional roles are similar. Likewise, in many situations, he finds out that voting behavior of the people is not driven by the ideology. Many times, people working in office, business houses, through interpersonal communication, they develop an inclination towards voting in favor of a given political party. That he calls as machine politics, boss politics. You go to the office to work, but when you come back from the office, you have developed a kind of political conviction, ultimately deciding which party to vote in favor of and which party not. So therefore, political, you know, roles are undertaken by non-political institutions. They are quite latent, they are not manifest. Therefore, social life is a sum total of these kind of paradoxes, these kind of probabilities, what functional theory in sociology should be taking care of. Therefore, he induces dynamism into functional theory, trying to take functional theory from the domain of determinism. It must be kept in mind that functionalism came out as an alternative to Marxian theory. Marxian theory was criticized as an economic deterministic approach. But functional theory evolved into a new kind of deterministic approach. When Marxism theory talks about inevitability of conflict, functional theory is glorifying the idea of integration. Therefore, old determinism is replaced by new determinism. Merton makes an attempt to liberate sociology from the bondage of this determinism. He brings novelty into sociological imagination and evolving a realistic sociology that was absolutely missing out both in the writings of Marx and also writings of Talcott Parsons. While discussing about latent and manifest functions and dysfunctions, he is looking into the contributions of many sociologists. He tells that if one looks into Sigmund Freud talked about Oedipus complex and Electra complex, indicating that son has got implicit sexual proximity or attachment towards mother, and daughter is having implicit sexual proximity towards father. So this implicit is not visible, but that attachment is manifested in terms of closeness, emotivity, and proximity between the people belonging to a particular family. In the same direction, if one looks into the writings of Himal Dorkheim, Dorkheim tells that people in simple society, they go for rituals. In a ritual, one will be finding out people are singing together, they are dancing together, they are glorifying their religious ideas. But at the same time, this form of coming together, dancing together, eating together, is implicitly promoting a sense of unity and solidarity among the members of the society. Therefore, rituals in case of tribal societies do have a latent goal. And that latent goal, Dorkheim tells, is promoting a form of social solidarity. Manifest goal is commitment to religion. And latent function is social unity and social harmony. Another interesting explanation of these latent functions is also being spelled out by William Graham Sumner. Sumner writes that people manifest a kind of behavior to gratify their immediate needs. But when they follow same procedure to gratify these needs, recurrently appearing in their way of life, this continuous practice gives rise to the growth of norms, the growth of usages, the growth of customs. Therefore, nobody makes a custom in a pre-planned manner. Therefore, customs develop in society in an unplanned manner. It is primarily a latent mode of orientation that gives rise to manifest growth of customs in society. Therefore, in many situations, we do certain things which do not carry intended consequence. But when these consequences are make appearance, we dance in joy. Therefore, life is not so systematized as it is being spelled out by persons. Life is full up with permutations and combinations. Respecting to these variabilities, one should be conducting sociological research. Therefore, sociological research should be bounded by facts. It should not be based upon speculation and imagination. He is further looking into the analysis of Jenansky and W.I. Thomas. Both of them are studying peasant cooperatives in Poland. They find out that cooperatives were formulated in Poland to offer credit facilities to the farmers, to address to their economic problems by granting them loans at the time of their need, to give them different kinds of training, how to use their productive potentials in a very positive manner. But ultimately, participating in these peasant cooperatives, most of the peasants, they got informations about larger social world by watching television, reading newspapers, communicating with each other. They became more conscious about what is happening in the larger social world. This was a latent orientation. And ultimately, peasant community, a little tradition of peasants, got associated with the great tradition of the society's culture and politics. Therefore, in many spheres of life, we should be finding out that manifest goal may be one, but latent goals are many, and latent goals can be functional, dysfunctional, non-functional, what we must have to primarily study as sociologists. I'm giving few examples here. You know, most of the time, newspaper reporters, agencies of the government, they give certain kind of explanation about manifest and latent functions or dysfunctions of specific institutions. Take for example slum. Most of the time we consider slums do have a terrible dysfunctional role to play, which are manifest. Because slums are giving habitation to drug addicts. Criminals are living in slums. Slums are unhygienic conditions. Slums are not primarily, you know, space where civic culture is present. There is a gentleman whose name is Oscar Lewis. He tells people living in slums suffer from cultural poverty. But Morton will be indicating that slums are offering services to the people living in the heartland of the cities. If there are no slums, the functionality of government will not be visible. Government is introducing slum resettlement programs. So this is making government more visible. Slums are primarily helping non-governmental organizations to undertake welfare programs there. Slums are catering to the needs of the poorest sections of the society. Therefore, these are invisible roles of the slums that need to be taken into consideration by sociologists. Therefore, one should not be jumping into the conclusion that every institution is having a specific functions or specific dysfunctions. Many functions are visible, many functions are not. Therefore, one has to develop a net balance analysis about functions, dysfunctions, and non-functions associated with every institution. Emphasizing on this fact, Morton indicates that crime should not be considered as a dysfunctional phenomena in every society. People go for deviant behavior, criminal behavior, for the reason that they adhere to the culturally prescriptive means in identical manner. But in many situations, they are not in a position to accomplish their goals. There is a huge gap between commitment to culture and accomplishment of goals. This dichotomy mostly leads to manifestation of criminal behavior. Therefore, he tells deviance is present in every society. And deviance itself is having functional, dysfunctional and non-functional roles to play. Therefore, while looking into deviance as a kind of act, we should not be jumping into the conclusion that deviance is having positive roles to play or negative roles to play. And he tells deviance need to be studied in every possible detail. While speaking about this deviance, he tells that American culture glorifies the ideology that anybody can become rich if he is committed to hard work, if he manifests rational behavior, if he goes for education, if he goes for individualism. Therefore, specific values are spelled out for the citizens of America, irrespective of their ethnicity, gender, age, and if they stay committed to these values, they can become rich in American society. Therefore, America glorifies the idea of equality of opportunity. America considers itself as an achieving society. But still in America, one finds out many people conform to the culturally prescriptive norms, but they are not in a position to accomplish their goals. So this gap between the means and the ends is giving rise to the acceleration of deviance and conflict in American society. That he explains in a very brilliant manner. He tells there are different categories of people. There are conformists who conform to institutionalized prescriptions of norms. And some of them accomplish the goals. But there are many, those who go to school, put hard work, follow rules of law, still waiting to primarily accomplish their goals. Goals are nowhere coming close to them, but still they have hope that one day or the other, their goal will be accomplished. Button tells this conformist, they live in a hope that one day they'll be able to accomplish their goals. Therefore, they are wasting their time, putting their effort, thinking that goal will be attended one day. But unless until these goals are attended, it is very difficult to say that their behavior is primarily a kind of positive behavior. Second category of people he is bringing in are ritualists. Ritualists are the ones, those who keep on primarily going the work on a continuous basis, following rules of law, once again going for education, and never ever in their lifetime they are in a position to accomplish the goals. Many such people, all through their life, they have done only one thing. In a very systematic, ritualistic manner, they have followed the rules of law. But ultimately nothing came to their hand and they stood as poor, marginalized, deprived sections of the society. So these groups of people are ritualists. And ritualists are also a body of deviants because they are not able to establish a correspondence between means and goals. Then he speaks about the innovators. Innovators are the people, those who are primarily using new methods. They stay away from culturally prescriptive means. They give more importance on goals, manipulate rules and law. In case of America, Button finds out, there are primarily present drug syndicates, corrupt politicians. They never conform to rules of law, but ultimately they become famous through violation of rules of law by creating a space for themselves in the public sphere. These bodies of people are known as innovators because society gives them respect. They are known for their accomplishment, but they have not conformed to rules of law in a systematic, in a very organized manner. Then he speaks about a retreatist. A large body of people find out that conforming to the means can no way take them in the direction of the accomplishment of goals. They consider that means may be followed, but goal is far away from them. Therefore, they reject both the means and the goals as well. They become hippies. They become drug addicts. They lose faith in the system. And losing faith in the system, they create a kind of new culture for themselves. These kind of people, those who are deviating absolutely from the normative prescriptions of the culture, keep new goals for themselves and pursue these goals, they are known as retreatists. And finally, there are some people who are thinking that some of the norms and rules should not be followed. They accept to some of the norms and reject the others. Bring in new kind of norms, and partly they accomplish their goals, and partly they put forward new body of goals. Therefore, these kind of people are the rebellions. Therefore, Button categorically points out that deviants are present in every society, and deviants are present because in every society, there is a gap between institutionalized prescriptions of norms and culturally designed goals. Therefore, gap between the two give rise to the persistence of deviance in every society, whether traditional or modern. This theory of deviance is coming as an extension of Emil Durkheim's theory of anomy. Durkheim tells that anomy is a social condition. When a simple society is going in the direction of complexity, during the period of transition rules, norms, regulations are all broken down. Therefore, people become the master of their own destiny. They pursue their own goals in an arbitrary manner. So therefore, in this transitional stage, anomie sustains or anomie prevails. Robert K. Burton tells that anomie is not a product of social change. Anomie is a normal condition present in the life course of every society. In every society, one finds out anomie is present because social life is creating space for anomie. Goals of the people are not accomplished. Norms are not identically internalized. Therefore, how is anomie present? Intensity of anomie, functions and dysfunctions of anomie, manifest and latent roles of anomie should be considered as the subject matter of sociology. Therefore, Burton tries to bring a kind of modification in grand functional theory forwarded by Talcott Parsons. And he tells that we should be going for developing a structure functional paradigm that will be more close to reality than being primarily an idealistic model. I'll be now taking up the theoretical question, which is so central to the sociology of Robert K. Burton. Prior to Robert K. Burton, we had mega theories in sociology. One mega theory is given by Karl Marx. Another mega theory, challenging to this mega theory of Marx, is given by Talcott Parsons. When Parsonian theory talks about social persistence, continuity, to its contrast, Marxian mega theory talks about dialectics, conflict, and social change. These mega theories consider that facts should simply fit into theories. Theories are universally applicable. Theories will be reflecting and guiding social change. Therefore, many sociologists were more primarily committed to theories than giving importance on empiricism. Robert K. Burton realized that positivists, they give too much of importance on empirical facts. Therefore, sociology is having two paradoxical traditions. One say, study facts as facts, and the other say, let facts simply come and fit into theories. The contradiction between these two traditions were somehow addressed by Max Weber. Weber has given importance on the development of ideal type. While speaking about ideal type, Weber indicates that there are historical developments like growth of capitalism, like development of Christianity, rise of legal rational authorities. These are historical developments. To understand this historical development, one should develop ideal types. Therefore, when Weber talks about ideal types, he indicates that ideal type is a kind of model. It's a form of design, purposively constructed by the sociologist. And using this ideal type, one can understand the essentialities of the reality. Therefore, ideal type is a purposively constructed model, the elements of which a sociologist chooses. And choosing these elements of reality, he makes an attempt to understand the essence of reality. Burton finds out some problem in this ideal type. He tells that ideal type is addressing to big questions, large questions, historical events. But sociologists must have to study those realities which are having empirical significance. For example, there is a kind of problem in race relationship among the blacks and whites in America. There is a constant increase in the number of drug addicts. There is primarily found out certain kind of problems related to corruption in administration. Therefore, sociology is addressing to these kind of questions. And to address to the smaller questions, which are affecting to the everyday life of man, one cannot construct an ideal type. Therefore, he rejects mega theories, also looks into the limitations of mechanical positivism, and makes a revision to Weberian ideal type. Revising this Weberian ideal type, he is bringing in a concept called as middle range theory. He writes that to construct this middle range theory, we should collect evidence from the facts. And middle range theory as the are the effective explanations of the essence of empirical facts. They are not difficult to comprehend. They are not abstract. They are based upon lower level abstractions. So he tries to bring theory close to the facts, because theories will be offering a broad framework through which facts can neatly be explained. Therefore, he tells, sociology builds up theories to offer a guideline to the explanation of facts. Theories should not be developed in sociology to glorify a sociologist. Therefore, let sociological theories be relevant to empirical context. Let sociological theory be so designed that they are not addressing to controversial issues. Let sociological theories be issue-based. Let sociological theories should not be primarily constituted to glorify society or to glorify revolution. Therefore, his heart and soul is going down to sociological research. How can we study specific problems? How can we explain these problems in a systematic manner without any value biasness? How can fact and theories be coming closer to each other? How sociology can justify itself as a discipline that can address to everyday needs of the people than being closer to philosophy? Therefore, modern sociology is more committed to a purposive sociological research that is relevant to understand the problems affecting to everyday life of man in different societies. He is not one of those scholars glorifying armchair sociology, talking about big theories, talking about glorification of the discipline. He is down to earth and making sociological research relevant to the everyday needs of the people. It is to be remembered that Robert K. Merton is very committed to scientific research in sociology, but at the same time, he is not a conventional positivist. Merton is considered as the founder of sociology of science. He finds out that the principles applicable to science can also be extended to sociology. He tells sociology should not be going for mechanical use of scientific method, but the essence of science, essence of scientific approach, can neatly be extended to sociology. And to glorify this idea that how science and sociology can come closer to each other, how science is the essence of sociological inquiry, he is talking about the basic elements of science. First, science is driven by the principle of communalism. That means a scientific group is always constituting a community. And being constituting a community, they share common ideas, exchange views with each other, and introspecting to the products of research of each other. Therefore, a sense of fraternity is developing among the scientists, irrespective of their ethnicity, race, nationality, social background. Therefore, scientists constitute a community, And because of this communalism, scientific research is making contribution for human life, human understanding of the truth in a very big way. Universalism, second feature of science. Scientific truth are universally valid. Scientific truth are not driven by the principle of egoism. So scientific truth carrying universal validity is primarily giving rise to the exploration of knowledge. Then scientists are greatly driven by the principle of disinterestedness. Scientists are not after money. Scientists are not after power. They are simply after knowledge. And organized skepticism. That means every scientist is going for the peer group review of his contributions. It is debated, it is discussed, it is analyzed, it is introspected. And on the basis of that, a particular finding of a scientist is being primarily coming for public review. Therefore, Robert K. Botter is an outstanding scholar who gave a new direction to sociology, introducing reference group theory, introducing middle lens theory, talking about the ethos of science, and most importantly, he discussed and debated against universal functionalism and offered a new dimension to sociological imagination of reality. Thank you.
So, Robert Merton's place is unique in the sociological
thinkers.
And he also excelled the contemporary
scholar, right? He died in 2003.
Okay.
And he was born in 1910.
Okay.
Longest living sociologist. Yes.
So, having applied this his principle, can we generate a society of the kind what he talked about?
Right. See, Robert K. Botter, he didn't have a very big ideology. He took interest in studying all problems taking place in society. In America, you know, around 1960s, political corruption was rampant. Bureaucratic corruption was rampant. Reflecting on that, he wrote a thesis on anomie. Why people go for corruption? How corruption is dysfunctional to society? He wrote on that. I think his sociology can be relevant to understand, you know, corruption today in case of India.
Yeah.
Civil society movement, how it is taking place and addressing to the issues of corruption. And I would be putting it in this way. Corruption may be bad to the society, but this incident of corruption is giving rise to the growth of new leaders. If there is no corruption, there will be no Anna Hazare. Therefore, you know, corruption may be dysfunctional to society, but it is giving rise to the growth of new leadership, bringing change in the rules of law.
So, well, friends, with these words, we would like to conclude the lecture today. We'll continue to our discussion on sociological thinker this week. So, today I thank all of you for watching the lecture, and on your behalf, I thank Dr. Subhas Mahapatra for giving such an insightful lecture on the sociological thinker Robert Merton. Thank you very much.